This is episode 88 of the Death to Tyrants podcast.
The crushing weight of the tyrant's passage had left nothing unmarked.
You get split in fucking half, but I call him the hologram wrath. But I am the center inside the placenta of math. You clash with cyanide gas and die fast. Rhythmical equivalent of solids, liquid, and gas. We smash your sinus with the power of Lord Titus. But I am the virus inside of the iris of Cyrus.
What's up, you guys? Welcome back once again to the Death to Tyrants podcast. As always, I am your host and humble narrator, Buck Johnson, coming to you out of Austin, Texas, where today I'm talking to Jimmy Morrison, the writer and director of an excellent new documentary and film called The Bubble. It's on the Great Recession of 2008, the housing bubble, that whole deal. And I know, like myself, you guys have friends that you've heard over the years pontificate and just spit out the most incorrect reasons on why that whole thing happened. And I know in your mind, you think, wait, how do I explain this to them that that's not correct? It's not deregulation that caused the Great Recession. Well, there's a lot of ways to explain what really happened to people. After seeing this documentary, I don't know that there's a better one than this way, because it's not only scholarly and academic and well put together, well produced, it's entertaining throughout. There's references to pop culture, there's old clips of shows and cartoons, as well as excellent stuff with Peter Schiff, Ron Paul, Bob Murphy, Mark Thornton, and all of these guys that had it right the whole time. They knew this stuff was coming. They warned. There's clips of Peter Schiff literally being laughed at by these talking heads as he's predicting what was to happen. And lo and behold, he was right. So it's put together and packaged so well. I can't speak highly enough of it. And it's just, he goes over the Federal Reserve, the Austrian boom bust cycle, everything that you love learning about. And it's done in such a great way. So, man, as you can tell, I can't say enough good stuff about it. The first time I saw it, I was with two friends that aren't necessarily consumed with this stuff, as I am and a lot of you guys are. And we watched it the whole thing through, and immediately both of them were saying, I want to watch that again. That was so good. And then, like myself, we're all going, oh, this is only part one. When's the second one come out? So we get to that one with Jimmy here in this interview, because it's like a good cliffhanger when you're watching a series and then all of a sudden it's over and you're like, wait, I want the second one. Is it out yet? When, you know, when do I get to see this? You're going to leave me hanging for months, Jimmy. We can't wait for part two already. So I will waste your time no longer ranting about how good this documentary is. We'll get to discussing it with the writer, the director, the producer. Jimmy Morrison is here. Jimmy, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, thanks for being here. We're here to talk about The Bubble, a documentary that you made. And I want to preface this for all of those who have not seen it yet. I loved it. And it's not just for lovers of all things economics, like some of these people listening to this show, you crazy people like myself. It's really palatable for a lot of people, a very wide audience. And the first time I watched it was with two friends who have very little interest overall, I'd say, in Austrian economics or the boom bust cycle. They were glued to the TV the whole time. And both of them not only loved it, they wanted to watch it again immediately. And then they're going, where's part two? So I wanted to start off with that for everyone listening. This is not just some documentary for academic eggheads that are very familiar with the boom bust cycle. It's very palatable for everyone. And with that intro, I'm glad you're here. Welcome.
Hey, I really appreciate your kind words, and I'm glad that they enjoyed the film. That's really something we spent a lot of extra time working on, of trying to make it accessible to the general public. And, you know, we wanted to make an economics film. It's not a political film, but we didn't, like you said, we didn't want it just to be a bunch of talking heads, and we wanted it to be something that people could laugh and enjoy and want to come back and watch it again, because really it's that second time watching it where you learn so much more because there's just so many little things in there that you can pick up on. But I think we were able to make a film that anybody from the general public, you don't even have to be that old to understand this film. I think people will really be able to check it out and have it come easy to them and kind of have that moment of clarity where everything kind of comes together and clicks into place where you're like, oh yeah, like, okay, I knew a lot of these things, but everything's kind of connected through all the, basically by the Federal Reserve, which is our root cause that we focus on in the film.
Yeah, excellent. It's so nice to see a film focus really truly on that institution. What do you do? Are you a full-time filmmaker?
That's interesting. Most people don't actually ask me that. I do video work, yeah, but I have a part-time job where I like to say that I'm a spy because I go into stores for their competitors and scan prices and like I can't give names or anything, but we have a lot of big clients at the company I work for, and they all these stores spy on each other because they want to know as soon as their competitor is like lowering their price or raising their price or changing the size of an item. And so it's really an interesting job for me because it allows me to just spend like, you know, 10 hours a week in stores on the ground, like actually seeing what's going on with prices in the country. So it's been interesting. I've been doing that for about 4 years, but on top of that, I do video work, and I'm going to be working on the sequel to this, as you mentioned, we're finishing up editing with. And then there's this film called The Iron Man that I'm going to be working on next year.
So your part-time job is kind of a great example of how the market works in general. You know, you go and see a price at a store on an item cheaper than another store, and then they've got to match it, it sounds like.
Yeah, it's interesting to see. And another thing that I've been able to see firsthand is obviously the price inflation, which, you know, hasn't been as bad the past few years, but we are starting to see it pick up a little bit. But also what we call shrinkflation, where instead of the prices going up, it's just that the items are getting smaller. And so like late this last summer, I noticed like Raisin Bran and dish soap was actually the containers were like 10-12% smaller than they'd been before. And so there's just lots of little things like that that when you're not paying attention, you don't even realize that your prices are going up. But it's just another way that it's affecting you.
So prior to making this film that we're talking about, The Bubble, did you have an interest in politics? Because I know I saw you say this somewhere. What kind of piqued your interest in the market failing per se, is you were painting houses around the time of the housing bust. So did you have a prior interest in politics or economics?
Yeah, so I graduated from high school in 2005. And in the 2004 election, they held a John Kerry rally in the school during school hours. And all the teachers were like, you guys should go to this. It'll be a great learning experience. And like they were passing out signs that like said the school name for Kerry and Edwards or whoever it was. I don't even remember who the vice presidential candidate was.
No bias at all there.
Yeah, but anyway, so I walked out of the school and called in to a talk radio show, which it was in our state in Iowa, and it was it gets picked up like all over the country. It's one of the biggest AM stations in the country. And so like the principal went home early because he didn't want to deal with all the phone calls they were getting from people complaining that they did this. And they were like confiscating signs if people had like Bush signs or anything like that, or even stickers. So it was kind of a weird experience, but the backlash from that, because I wrote a letter to the editor about like bias in schools, like in conjunction with that, and just the backlash from that really like turned me off from politics. And so I kind of stayed away from it for a while. But like you said, I was painting houses a few years later. I was doing video work and trying to use the painting as a way of funding my projects. And basically, I started the business right at the peak because that's what the profit signals were telling me. You know, that was the easiest way to make money at the time. So I just kind of watched that unfold and wanted to get back into economics. And I did a torrent search for audiobooks and the word economics. And this book, Economics in One Lesson, came up by Henry Hazlitt and kind of described the boom bust cycle a little bit. And it just gave me the idea that if there are people that wrote about this stuff, like back in the 1940s, like it made sense that I could track down the people that predicted it today and ask them why it happened and, you know, try to figure out what's next. And so at the time I had no idea what I was getting myself into. This was 2010, 2011. And I ended up driving 35,000 miles to do all the interviews. But it really was a transformational experience, like a huge learning experience. I didn't know anything about the Federal Reserve when I started the project. So although I had like a free market background, I didn't have the monetary education of economics. So
when you started, I guess, during like the rally, the John Kerry rally, and you were calling in to complain or writing letters to the editor, would back then were your politics just kind of more generically conservative?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. I was a typical Republican. I had grown up like learning about free trade from my dad. He was a development director at Islands for Tax Relief. So, you know, he taught me free market principles. And I, you know, in high school, I worked as a janitor at Islands for Tax Relief. And so, like, I was a terrible employee. I never got anything done, but I would, like, read stuff on all these people's shelves in their offices. And so I was learning about, like, the fact that they've already raided the Social Security Trust Fund and the government's just spent all that money. Like, I was reading about that in high school. But I definitely was more of a Republican. I didn't realize how anti-free market the Republican Party actually was at the time. But at the time, like, I supported the Iraq War. And I've been very radicalized against war since then, thanks to some people like Murray Rothbard and Gary Johnson. Actually, I worked for his presidential campaign, and he was very influential in just really calling me out on the issue and forcing me to do cost benefit analysis on it, which, you know, that sounds like a terrible way for you to come around on war. But that's really like what it took, was just years and years and, opening yourself up to it. Cause we kind of get conditioned and ingrained in our ideas. But that is one issue that I've transformed on for sure.
Were there moments, how should I phrase this? Were there moments during the filming of the bubble that helped develop your where you are politically now? Is it kind of a political journey just making this film? Or we all have, you know, a lot of us will start off like you, like kind of a generic conservative. And if you end up being an ANCAP or hardcore libertarian of any sort, there's always these moments that kind of radicalize you or lift the scales from your eyes, we'll say. Was that during the filming of this documentary?
Yeah, I mean, I was pretty radicalized before. I had started Iowa Patients for Medical Marijuana in 2008 and was a lobbyist with the Marijuana Policy Project for a while. And it that's something where if you have somebody, you know, somebody new reaching out to you every single week who's like, hey, I have this illness. You know, I got arrested for this small amount. I'm going to jail. Like, I don't know what to do. And, you know, I never had an answer for them. And even after years of work, like, it's been a decade and I'm not a lobbyist anymore. Somebody else runs the organization and everything. But like, there's really not been a ton of progress in Iowa. It's just a really backwards state politically. And so it really gives you a firsthand lesson of, you know, what these laws mean and the fact that when somebody says they think marijuana should stay illegal, they're actually saying that like they should put people in cages and take their kids away. And so you really see firsthand the consequences of these laws. And going into the bubble, like making the film, like just every step of the way, the taxes and the accounting and the regulations that you have to deal with, like me just getting DVDs and Blu-rays from a different country, I'm having to deal with all these customs forms and stuff. And it's just every step of the way, it just being an entrepreneur, it just, you see it swelling down the system and preventing growth. But to go on a little tangent, the thing that really radicalized me was I got mugged And a week later, I had cops search me, and they basically, it was basically the exact same experience where you're being held down and they're going through your socks and everything. And just having that happen so quickly together really showed me what the state is like and what police are like in that system. There was one year where I was actually detained. I've never been arrested, but I was detained 7 times in 1 year just because I looked young and they had curfew laws in the city I grew up in. And so I would walk into Come and Go after midnight and cops would just come up to me and search me and like phone my name, checking for warrants and stuff like that. So I think with the drug war and just kind of experiencing the police state firsthand, I think that's something that radicalizes a lot of people.
Yeah.
And I've even had a cop hold a gun to my head. I was searched once while a cop held a gun point blank to my brother's head and I had marijuana on me. So stuff like that is just like, you know, when that happens, something like abolishing the FDA doesn't seem so radical.
Right. Yeah. At the moment you've got a gun to your head, you realize who has the legal monopoly on violence and you can't do much about it. Right.
Exactly.
So let's talk about The Bubble. Was your initial vision of this film exactly what it turned out to be? Did it change directions throughout the filming? Tell me about that.
Yeah. So I actually, before I teamed up with Tom Woods, who co-wrote the film with me, I actually had reached out to Thomas Sowell, who is an economist, who is an Austrian and doesn't really focus on the Fed as much. And so when I first started the project, I was looking at that angle. But then when I started reading Tom and seeing his speeches, that's when everything kind of started clicking for me of what the film was going to be. But it started as a 4-part miniseries, like an extended version that I was going to try to condense down into one movie. And I had tried to do that for years and was unable to do so. And so I ended up just splitting it into 2 separate films. That's why we have The Bubble and then The Bigger Bubble that we're going to finish up here. It definitely transformed a lot over the years. And, you know, I hate to say it, but early on in the project, it was a bunch of talking heads and it was very academic. And so it took a lot of years to make that stuff really language that anybody could understand and have it be funny enough and have those moments where you have breaks with like Jon Stewart and Stephen Colbert and South Park and stuff like that, that really makes it hit home with people.
Yeah. And more relatable to the average person on the street. And did Tom Woods help you with that aspect of it?
Yeah, I mean, as far as the cartoons and stuff like that, that was more of my team. But he really helped with the writing process of, you know, what are the most important points we need to make and how are we going to make them so that people can understand them. And that's something that Tom's really good at, is he can take a page that you throw at him and then he'll just be like, you know, you're using all these words that you don't need to. Let's do it this way. And then suddenly it's something that that anybody can understand. And I think that's something that's been huge in his career, is all the people who wouldn't have been able to understand issues like this otherwise that are able to because of the stuff he's written.
Was it through him that you were able to get in contact with so many of these huge names, really, in the world of Austrian and free market economics? Was that done through Tom?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure many of them would not have done the interviews if it wasn't for their respect for him and his book Meltdown. I think a lot of it was persistence. You know, some of them still said no, and I just kept hounding them. And just when, you know, if you can go to a conference where you can meet some of these people, just when they're coming off the stage after they speak or anything like that, that's how I actually got a lot of my interviews. That's how I got an interview with Peter Schiff. You know, we set it up further down the line, but you just approach them and try to get them committed to something, because then you usually can make it happen. But we had other people that it just didn't work out. Like we were going to interview Peter Thiel, Drove halfway across the country and went to DC and like just wasn't able to work with his schedule. So you just never know. You just gotta, I guess you don't know unless you try.
And, yeah, sure.
I can't complain about all the people we got because the cast is really incredible.
It's really
some pretty amazing investors and economists in there.
Yeah, it's really good. That was one of the most impressive parts. Who was the most accommodating and easiest to work with, out of curiosity? And this is no slight on everyone else.
Ooh,
but was there was there someone that stood out as like, this guy's great to work with?
Yeah, I'll mention a couple of people. Robert Murphy, I interviewed him at the time he was living in Nashville or Franklin, Tennessee, right outside of Nashville. And so I was coming back from filming some interviews at the Mises Institute and set something up with him. But he was like getting ready to move or something, so he didn't have his office where we could shoot. And so I got this hotel room. And I based the hotel room that I got on what the pictures were on the website. And then I got there and it was just a shithole. Nothing like it. There were cockroaches. I mean, it was terrible. And so I had my tripod set up like half in the bathroom, half in like this little kitchenette area. And then he sat on a stool in the kitchen. With just like the background out of focus a little bit. And so like there was, you know, there was no way I could show that room. It had to just be a wall. But he came in and he had to go to the bathroom. And so he just stepped over the camera and took a leak real quick before the interview. So I would say that's pretty accommodating.
That is.
He handled the situation well. Gene Epstein, I actually had an issue where a setting had gotten changed on my camera and it put it in a variable frame rate mode, which meant that it didn't record the audio. And so I didn't have audio from our entire interview.
So he met
with me again and allowed me to reshoot the entire interview. So that was pretty awesome.
Wow. That is something. That was not, I can tell you firsthand, that's happened one time here as recording this podcast. I finished the entire interview and there was no audio. And you just want to crawl up in a corner and die, basically. So that's great that Epstein did that. I've heard you talk about some of the low points, and I do want to get to some of those because it does really show your efforts in making this thing. But I want to hear about some high points in making this film.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, I mean, there have been a lot of great moments. Way back in 2012, we released our teaser trailer at Freedom Fest in Vegas, which I highly recommend anybody go to. It's a couple thousand libertarians. You know, there are some more mainstream Republicans there, but it's mostly libertarians and tons of like huge free market speakers. It's a really great event. And so we premiered our teaser there and we had, I think there are probably like 1300 or 1400 people, at our premiere for that, which was pretty cool. Cause they actually had like a bunch of other things going on at that point, but almost everybody went to see our screening. And so at that event, I promised that I was going to bring the film back the next year. And then we actually had our world premiere at Freedom Fest, not the next year, but 6 years later in 2018. So to get to go back there and have that experience was pretty amazing. And then our New York City premiere was last June. And we did that with Jim Grant and Peter Schiff. And David Tice, our producer, Gene Epstein was there, Tom Woods was there, and Liz Clayman from Fox Business was the moderator for the panel, and that was an incredible event. But we've been doing screenings all over the country at colleges and stuff, and so, I mean, there's lots of high points. It's really fun to get out there and really travel the country and show this to people, and it's not something where we've just been preaching to the choir. Like, we did test screenings at Indian reservations, and, we've done screenings where we're just trying to get out to different audiences because we don't want this to just be for people who already believe this stuff. We want it to be the definitive documentary on the housing bubble, where if anybody wants to learn about this, this is the thing they go to watch. And I think it's something that we've done, and hopefully the bigger bubble, our next movie, will do that for the next crisis as well.
Yeah, I think if you are going to show it to a broad audience like you'd like to, like you're mentioning. You did a great job at showing like these clips of Peter Schiff and Ron Paul basically saying, this is going to happen. This is a bubble. It's going to pop. From, you know, Ron Paul's giving these speeches in 2001, I believe it showed in your film, all the clips of Peter Schiff getting laughed at by these idiot talking heads on Fox Business and wherever else he was appearing. And then all of a sudden, they were right. And so it does. It's hard at this point if you've got an audience that might have been not positively attracted to a film like this with this message. It's hard for them to argue at this point.
Yeah, and Peter Schiff is somebody that kind of has a reputation of always having all the answers and, you know, trying to, say he, you know, he gets accused of trying to put a timeline on it. And I think all of these people in the film aren't people that claim to be able to predict exactly when these things happen. They're just saying they know the consequences of the policies that have been put forth, and they know that eventually these crashes are going to happen. And so I think it's interesting that in our movie, we actually have a clip of somebody asking Peter Schiff how much house prices are going to fall and when it is. And he says, I don't know, which I guarantee we're the only ones that have Peter Schiff saying, I don't know, in a video. Yeah. So it's kind of funny after all these years of Peter Schiff was right videos. It's interesting. The one thing I've learned from the process of making the film is it's not about having all the answers. It's learning that nobody knows, and you really nobody can have all the answers and be able to run an economy with millions of people or run the Federal Reserve. Like, nobody knows what interest rates should be, and nobody knows when these crashes are going to happen. But hopefully we can learn enough with the lessons in these documentaries that we can at least protect ourselves a little bit and have an understanding that that these crashes are going to keep happening. And if you look at the dot-com bubble bursting and then them just replacing that with the housing bubble and then where we are today, it's something I think people need to be aware of, so they're not like I was with the housing bubble, where you're starting a house painting business at the worst possible time and getting in right before the crash.
Right. I almost feel like sometimes I'm so fortunate to always listen to the good guys, Tom Woods, Ron Paul, Bob Murphy, guys we've mentioned today. I almost feel spoiled at how good they are that sometimes I'm not really familiar with the lousy takes on this stuff, if that makes sense. Do you run what are some of the false narratives that you still hear on the housing bubble or the Great Recession? Do you still hear bad takes on these?
Oh, all the time. Everybody just points at Glass-Steagall and says that this one deregulation from 1999 is the reason everything happened. And when you look at the companies that were at the heart of the crisis that failed, like, none of them were affected by that regulation in any way. And it's something that people are just pointing to it because it's an easy out for them to blame deregulation. So that's something you see all the time. And it's kind of maddening, the idea that, you know, people used to say that that we needed prices to stay the same or at least be rising a little bit. And now they're saying that, you know, even their 2% targets aren't enough. They want it to be higher than that. And the economy isn't going to be good unless we have inflation higher than that. And it's just kind of crazy at this point in history that we're still in a world where people are trying to keep prices going up as if that's going to make everybody better off. But, you know, I mentioned that I dropped out of school. The economics book at the University of Iowa, like, the main macroeconomics book, was actually written by Ben Bernanke. So it's interesting that, like, in high schools and colleges, you're going and you're stuck just learning from the guy down the street, but the textbook they're using is coming from the guy that's running the Federal Reserve. And we're in an interesting time where there's all these alternative forms of education, and like the Mises Institute puts out all this stuff. And like you said, there's all these economists that we have access to. And it's just, why would anybody want to go learn economics from the guy down the street when they can listen to Murray Rothbard recordings? Yeah. You know, like, that's how I learned economics. Was I took Joseph Salerno's economics classes by listening to all of them. And I listened to every recording of Murray Rothbard I could find. And the Mises Institute makes it very easy for people to get an education. And it's something that I think people are kind of coming around to the idea that maybe college isn't the right answer for most people. And unless you need some sort of certification with it, it's not necessarily the virtue signal that it used to be.
Right. That's for sure. Although there's a lot of virtue signaling at the colleges, of course. That's a whole nother story.
Yeah, that too.
Speaking of bad takes, there's still a lot of them on the Great Depression, bad takes out there. And I thought it was cool that you covered not only that, but there's a segment in the film on the Depression of 1920-21. It never, ever gets talked about. Can you discuss that one really quick and give my listeners a small insight as to how y'all covered it and maybe what the outcome of that one was?
Yeah, absolutely. I can think it's safe to claim that we're the only documentary that talks about the Panic of 1920, at least the only documentary that compares it to the Great Depression, which is really an interesting comparison because they really did the exact opposite things. In the Great Depression, tax revenue goes way down when there's a crash. You know, obviously there's less business going on, so the tax revenue that comes from that business is going to be smaller. And in the Great Depression, they just ramped up spending and had these huge deficits, and they pushed down interest rates. But back in 1920, when there was the crash after World War I, what they did was they allowed interest rates to go back up, and they actually cut spending in half, not just like the increase in spending in half. They actually cut government spending in half completely and started paying down the national debt. So it's really the exact opposite of what the United States did after the housing crash and after the dot-com crash, and what they did with the Great Depression. So it's not something where you can just say, hey, we're going to take these two perfect things and compare them. You know, there's obviously a lot more variables than that. But it's something that the idea of cutting spending even a little bit is just unheard of at this point in time. You know,
right.
We're so far from that even being in the realm of possibility that it's kind of hard to imagine.
Yeah. Yeah, no doubt. Okay. We got to get to at least a tale or two of the hardships that you had creating this film. And I've heard about some of them, and I'm not jealous of it, but because really it does though. I am jealous that you got to go hang out with Ron Paul, but the stuff that you went through really shows your dedication to making this. So can you talk about some of that?
Yeah, sure. So I'm sure what you're talking about is the fact that I would get really anxious and throw up the morning of most of these interviews.
Yeah.
I mentioned that I drove over 35,000 miles. For the beginning of the project, I was driving my car and sleeping in the back of my car. And then I would get sick in the morning out of the car and then have to go find a gas station to get cleaned up and then put on a suit. Like, I'd wash my hair in the gas station bathrooms, which you actually have to find the right bathroom because these days some of them have like the environmental faucets or whatever where they're turning off all the time.
Oh,
and that's
wow.
It's impossible to wash your hair in that. But so yeah, like I definitely didn't have the means to be doing what I was doing, but if somebody's halfway across the country, like sometimes you just got to jump in your car and go do it. And so there were a lot of sacrifices early on. And as I mentioned earlier, or I think I mentioned this, that we did go bankrupt a little bit back in 2015, kind of overextended ourselves and hired more crew than we could afford and that sort of thing. And really, it just took too long. The project took longer than I had hoped. And so went bankrupt with that. And then even in 2017, I was actually in a car accident that was pretty serious. I had a hernia, and I didn't know what it was, and I pushed on it and actually passed out from the pain while I was driving, and I had my cruise control on, and so I hit a pole going 50 miles an hour, and my seatbelt didn't lock, and my airbags didn't go off. And so that was kind of a wake-up call of like,
wow. Oh,
if I don't actually get this movie done and get it out there, it's not going to exist. So there were definitely a lot of hardships along the way. But like we were talking about earlier, it just really makes it all worth it to get the film out to people. And we've had a really positive reaction. I don't know what the film is ranked now, but I think it's over 8.5 stars on IMDb. So that means a lot to have people like you recounting stories of friends that are learning these new ideas. And
yes,
that's kind of the core idea, is that people aren't going to read a book about this. There's a huge section of the population that doesn't have the time or the will to read a book about this. But if we can sit them down for 40 minutes or an hour and a half, we can teach them a whole hell of a lot of economics, as long as we're making it fun and interesting. And that's what I think we've done.
Yeah, it is. It's like I said, you mentioned it a few times, the humor, the old school cartoons were really cool. The pop culture, the star power, all being rolled together in basically what's an entertaining educational documentary. It's I love it. What are you most proud of with this film?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I would say I'm going to cheat and have two answers.
Okay.
I think our the way we explain like the theory behind Austrian business cycles and the way that we then apply that to the housing bubble, and then kind of weave it throughout the film. I'm really proud of the way that I think we really did a lot of justice to the school, which is something I felt a lot of weight on me of, that I, you know, the economists that have come before are just so effective and such great writers that I really wanted to be able to do something where people could easily understand their ideas. So I'm really proud of that. And then the other thing is the scenes about World War II and World War I. I'm really proud of those because I think most documentaries, when they show war, you just see people run around shooting and maybe you see some buildings blow up or whatever. But I think we really showed the human costs of war and did a good job of showing the actual horror of it, but doing it in a way that people are still able to take in the fact that we're talking about the economic costs of war and what that did to the population at home. And we really take on the issue that people claim that war is good for the economy, because yes, I think that's such a horrific idea. And it's something that has really damaging consequences when government officials think, oh, if we just build more jets and send more people over to bomb people, that it's going to boost our economy. It's really a dangerous path to go on. So I'm really proud of our scenes that we did on the wars.
Yeah, that's I'm glad you mentioned that, because anytime someone discusses, writes about, or shoots about whatever, the Federal Reserve, I think it's super important to relate that to, without it, we wouldn't have a lot of these ridiculous wars and ongoing wars and longest war in American history, what we're currently in the middle of, hopefully not the middle, maybe the end. But yeah, I'm glad that you guys related that, because you could have easily just said the Federal Reserve and just stuck with the boom bust aspect and the Austrian business cycle. But yeah, relating it to war was really, really important. So I'm glad you guys did that.
Yeah, I don't think it's a coincidence that the 20th century was the century of central banks printing a bunch of money, and it was also the century of mass world wars.
Right.
And like you said, the war on terror, there's no way that if people were having to write checks every month or every year, that the public would put up with what they've done the last 20 years if they were actually having to pay for it directly, instead of just having the Federal Reserve print money and end up getting all these all this government debt buying it up. It's really a crazy world we live in, and it seems like with this next crash, it's only going to get crazier. So it's going to be an interesting ride. So we'll have to enjoy it and come back and talk another time.
Yeah, no doubt. Real quick before we go, I've got a couple more. When is part two coming out? And tell the folks what part two covers.
Yeah, so the second film, as far as when it comes out, who has any idea? Definitely not me. but hopefully we'll be doing test screenings later this summer or this fall. But I'll just have to keep people posted on that. But as far as what it covers, it starts with the bailouts in 2008 and brings everything up to today. And so it really gets into, people may have heard of quantitative easing and all the things that the Federal Reserve was doing. And really the last 10 years has all been based on the idea that they were going to unwind all that. They bought all this government debt. They bought all this mortgage debt, and they printed insane amounts of money to do that. And the promise was always, we're going to wind that down, we're going to sell all that stuff off. And now when it's come time to actually sell it off a little bit, they panicked because the economy started to crash. And so they're just buying up even more. So it's kind of an interesting time where the markets and the public haven't necessarily realized that the last 10 years are starting to shift over. But there are definitely signs that things are changing, and we're going to have to deal with another crash. And what's crazy is when the crash happened last time, they had a $1 trillion deficit. But now the crash hasn't even necessarily started yet, and we already have over a $1 trillion deficit. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting how much worse shape the economy is in. Obviously, there is a boom phase. And when you print all this money and inject it in, you know, people are going to think things are going good for a while. But I think we're going to find that a lot of this growth, in fact, has not been what we hoped it was.
Are you guys expecting any large format distribution in the future, like Netflix, Amazon, or anything like that?
Well, we're going to approach them with the second film and kind of take it to them as a package of both films. But at this point, honestly, they don't, unless you're a Netflix original, they don't pay enough for us to justify giving away our rights. But people can get the film at thebubblefilms.com or letusdisagree.com, which is my production company. It's just $10, and they can get a digital copy through Vimeo, where they can stream it or download it forever. Or they can get the Blu-ray and DVD. And there's options for sending it to friends and that sort of thing. So it's really something that I think people are going to enjoy. We've got special features on there with panels, with a lot of our cast members and stuff like that, and some music videos I've done, some of which were shot down in Austin in your neck of the woods.
Nice, okay.
Yeah, I think people really enjoy the film, and hopefully we'll be able to get it out to even more people as the second film comes out and as it gets the project gets bigger and bigger.
Excellent. Well, you just covered all the things I was about to ask you, and I will link I will link to all of your stuff in the show notes page so people can find where to get the film and where to find you and everything. Jimmy Morrison, thank you so much for being here on Death to Tyrants.
Hey, thanks for having me. And I agree, death to tyrants.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, guys. So as I always do, I'll put the links in the show notes page. Jimmy's website is letusdisagree.com. And on there, you can figure out exactly how to watch The Bubble. And I hope after all that chat about it, if you've not seen it already, you're ready to see it. Again, I can't speak highly enough of this documentary, this film Jimmy made. Well done, young man. Well done. And also, you guys, I'd like to tell you, if you're on the fence about joining the LP, the Libertarian Party, let me push you into joining. We are making some progress, and we were going to try to have a new chair elected here at the National Convention. The National Convention is here in Austin, Texas, in just a few months. And we're also going to try and get Jacob Hornberger elected by the delegates, which I hope to be one, to be the presidential nominee for the Libertarian Party. So if you haven't heard my interview with Jacob Hornberger, go back a few episodes and find that. And I think you'll be sold on exactly how good he is. If you'd like to join the LP, the Libertarian Party, I've got a link for you. If you listen to the show, the LP welcomes you to their party, to our party, as it is now, www.lp.org/deathtotyrants. It's that easy. Also, find me on Facebook. You guys know that already. facebook.com/deathtotyrantspodcast. You can find me on Twitter at Buck Rebel, BUCKREBEL. And last but not least, if you choose to support this show financially, which you guys have been doing now, it's so cool to get these little notifications. You've got a new supporter. It's at Patreon, patreon.com/deathtotyrants. And I truly, truly appreciate that. As I've said multiple times, every penny made off the Patreon page goes right back into this show. I can promise you that. And I guess that's all for now. Guys, go get The Bubble. Go support Jimmy Morrison. Watch this show. It's so so good. And until next week, I'll see you later. Have a good one.
You get split in fucking half, but I call him the hologram wrath. But I am the center inside the placenta of math. You clash with cyanide gas and die fast. Rhythmical equivalent of solids, liquid and gas. We smash your sinus with the power of Lord Titus. But I am the virus inside of the iris of Cyrus.
Like the sound of the Death to Tyrants podcast? Our audio production is provided by Podsworth Media. Check them out at podsworth.com.